Today we're talking about physician's loans, doctor's loans. If you're a medical resident, a doctor in training looking to purchase a house here in the greater Iowa City area, you may be wondering what your options are. A lot of medical residents come in with a pretty high debt to income ratio, which can really limit the sort of mortgage lending options out there for you. Today we're going to chat with a lender from Green State Credit Union, a local lending institution here in the Iowa City area, about what some of the options are and what a lot of medical residents end up doing in order to find and purchase a house to fit their needs while they're here in the Iowa City area. Hey there, my name's Emily Farber and I'm a realtor with Let the Krieger Realtors in Iowa City. I create YouTube content all about real estate and Iowa City, designed to help people just like you make the right choices, informed choices, when it comes to real estate. If you are interested in buying, selling, or relocating in the Iowa City area, you should check out some of my free downloadable guides down below in the description box of this video. Now, let's get going with our chat with Pete Johnson of Green State Credit Union. We are going to hop over onto a Zoom call and hear what he has to say. Today, we are talking with Pete Johnson from Green State Credit Union here in the greater Iowa City area. The topic of today's video is doctor's loans, mortgage loans that are specifically designed for people who are going into a residency program or are doctors just starting out in their practice. Hey, Pete, how are you doing today?
Hey there, how's it going?
Good, thank you. So let's talk a little bit about debt to income ratios for a doctor's loan versus your standard mortgage loan.
Yeah, so for the most part, debt ratio, I guess I should kind of explain what debt ratio is because a lot of people don't always understand that. But your debt ratio, you know, simply is basically the percentage of income you have coming in versus what's going out. So for example, if you had, you know, $2,000 of income for coming in per month, 43% of that is $860 per month. So they like to see $860 a month being used to apply towards like your home loan, any other debts you have, student loans, car loans, credit cards, stuff like that. 43% is kind of the magic number. It's not the be-all, tell-all number. We can go sometimes a little bit higher, a little bit lower than that. So there isn't a set number per se, but generally speaking, when we're lending money, we're doing loans, we're kind of targeting 43% or less of your gross income going out to pay those items. They consider the other 57% or so of your income is going out to pay things like taxes and healthcare and, your utilities, things like that, entertainment, food, things like that, right? But that 43% is kind of basically what they're looking at for items that are like loans, credit cards, car loans, student loans, things like that. For med residents, it's not really actually altogether that different than just anyone else. Med residents or doctors, physicians, it's not different really for anybody else. That debt ratio is still the same. So that's kind of what we're targeting basically.
Okay. So what are some of the other challenges that a medical resident might face when they're looking to buy a house and get a mortgage for it?
Absolutely. So the biggest thing for med residents, I would say really two things. One is down payment, right? Because you always hear, from people that you're talking to that have gotten loans and, maybe your parents or other people that have gotten loans and maybe haven't done a loan for 10 or 15 or 20 years or more, that you need to have 20% down, right? 20% is kind of that magic number that always sticks in everybody's mind. And that's really not the case these days. With the lending that we're doing these days, we can put as little as no money down. We have programs for no money down, believe it or not. But you can put as little as 5, 10, 15, it really doesn't matter. 20% is the magic number for what we consider a conventional fixed rate loan. And so a lot of residents coming out of medical school, every once in a while I call the magical unicorn med resident that's coming, or medical students coming out of med school about to enter their residency with tons of down payments. Maybe they had a parent, that was gracious enough to give some money to them and actually had the 20% down or 5 or 10 or whatever they prefer to put down. you know, but the vast majority don't. So the biggest thing is you're coming out of, you know, medical school, logically with a lot of student loan debt, right? So you don't have a lot of cash. You haven't really been working. You've been, you know, working your butt off in medical school. You haven't really been working in a job, so to speak, where you've had a lot of time to save cash. So down payment's probably the number one issue. I'd say the vast majority of residents that I work with are coming up, are coming into my office with, you know, 1 or 2% or generally no money down. And so that's a huge obstacle, number one. Number two is student loan debt. You know, like I said, like I find every once in a while a medical student coming out with no student loan debt. Maybe they got, you know, we're fortunate enough to have parents or somebody that covered their student loans. But the vast majority are coming out of medical school with anywhere from, you know, $100,000 to $300,000 or $400,000 in student loan debt. So
kind of debt that makes us feel a little.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. You know, so obviously that's a big issue. And even though your student loans are deferred, you know, when we're doing conventional fixed rate loans, which we'll kind of talk about a little bit, you know, they still count those student loan payments against you. They'll actually assign a number, a certain percentage. It's usually either 0.5 or 1% of your loan balance as a student loan payment. And so if you have $100,000 in student loan debt, for example, I'm just using that for simple math here, 1% would be $1,000 per month. Most medical residents are coming in, you know, making under $6,000 per month, usually under $5,000 per month, especially in your first year of residency. And so that can be a big hit to your overall debt ratio, especially if you have more like $200,000. You know, when we talk about those debt ratios being 43%, that can pretty easily eat up all the available money that you have, qualified money, I should say, in your debt ratio because of that. And so that number can be as little as a half a percentage point, so it could be 500 to 1,000. But nonetheless, the number's really big. And so a lot of times that will disqualify, you know, medical residents right off the bat from a standard conventional fixed rate loan. So.
Okay, well, that's the perfect segue then. Why don't you tell us a little bit about loan products that are specifically designed for medical residents and doctors that Green State offers?
You bet. So when we're talking about loans, we're kind of talking about two categories of loans. So when I talk to people about loans, usually what I lead in with is there's two kinds of loans that we do. We've got what are called standard conventional fixed rate loans. These are the loans that your parents are going to talk about. Mm-hmm. 30-year, 20-year, 15-year fixed rate loans. These loans are spread out over, say, 30 years, and the interest rate is locked in for all 30 years, never changes, okay? And generally speaking, if you're going to be there for the long run, if you're going to be there for 10, 15, 20 years or more, we would likely try to go that route. The downside, we kind of talked a little bit about that, is that the downside to the conventional fixed rate loans is that they are all they're all backed by Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, the two great big huge mortgage giants. That back all conventional loans. And because they back them, they insure them, so to speak, they make the rules. So all banks, doesn't matter if you work with a credit union like Green State, or you're working with a regional local bank, or you're working with U.S. Bank or Bank of America or Chase, makes no difference. We all follow the same Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac guidelines, and they're the ones that are going to require that minimum monthly payment of 1% or a half a percentage point of your loan balance on those student loans. And so you're going to find yourself running into trouble when you start going down the conventional fixed rate path if you have those student loans, because it's most likely going to disqualify you. And so that's the source of a lot of frustration for residents, is that they, you know, they thought there was a physician's loan available and they're wondering why they're not getting qualified for it. It's because they're trying to take you on a conventional fixed rate loan. What we'll normally do 9 out of 10 times. Is we will do what's called an in-house loan. So this is a loan that's different than the conventional fixed rate loans in that they're going to be kept here at Green State. We call them in-house because we keep them here. We don't sell them out on the secondary market. And as a result, they are not backed by Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. And that means we can have some flexibility. In Iowa City here, we obviously live in a big college town with a major teaching hospital. And so we do a lot of physician loans. I'm actually located sandwiched right in between. My physical office is within walking distance of both the UIHC and Mercy Hospital. So I do a ton of physician loans. So this is something we're very, very used to. And we know how these loans get paid back. We know how they function. And so we offer in-house loans for that purpose because we don't have to follow those rules. Now, the in-house loans are a little bit different, and most in-house loans are. Not all banks offer in-house loans, I should say. Through the vast majority of the bigger banks, the U.S. banks, the Bank of America's, don't offer in-house loans. They may have a physician's loan program, but it's usually tied to that conventional fixed rate program that's backed by Fannie and Freddie. Those are hard to qualify for, right? So on our in-house loans, we understand that you're going to be in a 4 or 5 year residency. You might have a 1 or 2 year fellowship even after that. So we understand that you're going to have a period where your student loans are deferred. And so we don't count those against you. So we don't use that 1% or 0.5% minimum monthly payment requirement, okay? So right off the bat, your debt ratio is really not a factor. You know, most residents that I'm working with don't have a whole lot of other debt. You might have a car loan, you might have a credit card or two, but you're not really loaded up with debt other than the student loans. And so that's gonna open you up to qualifying from an overall debt ratio perspective. The other nice thing about our in-house loans is that we do not require any money down. So that's huge, there's zero down payment requirements. You can do 100% financing at a good rate. These are rates that are very comparable and usually less than the conventional 30-year fixed rates that are backed by Fannie and Freddie. We can do those in-house here at rates that are still approximately the same. The major difference between the conventional fixed rates and the in-house loans is that our in-house loans are what we call ARMs, or ARMs. So they're adjustable rate mortgage is what that stands for. And that can sound pretty scary at first, but it's not when we take into account time. So for most residents, the maximum amount of time you're gonna be here is maybe 4 or 5 years. So the vast majority are gonna be here 4 or 5 years. And then you're going to move on to a fellowship, maybe out of town, maybe here, but maybe out of town, most likely out of town usually, to a different location. And so generally speaking, you don't really need your interest rate locked in for 30 years or 20 years or 15 years. You really only need the interest rate locked in or secured so that it doesn't change for maybe 4 to 6 years, maybe 7 years tops. And so our adjustable rate loans are set to adjust after 5, 7, or 10 years. We have three options there. Okay. So a 5-year ARM, for example, would be spread out over 30 years, just like a 30-year fixed rate is, but the interest rate would only be locked in for 5 of the 30 years. Uh-huh. And then in the 6th year, the rate would adjust to whatever the market rate is at the time. So it's not like they are adjusting every year. They're fixed for a set period of time. Coincidentally, on our 5 years, most popular for our residents, at a rate of 2.5%, ridiculously wow. low, lower than 30-year right now. Yeah, so it saves you some money there. So there's really no reason to pay a premium rate on the 30-year fixed rate. You might pay more like 2.875 or 3% right now versus 2.5. You're really paying that extra interest for time that you don't need. You're not going to be there for 30 years. So it's actually better for you to go with the ARM loan anyway. Even if you qualify for a 30-year fixed rate, you'd be better off with that type of program. So
that's a great point. I mean, I can totally confirm what you're saying. A lot of buyers walk into the home buying process in their mind thinking, this is going to be my forever home, or this is going to be my home for a long time, like 15 years. But experience and statistics show me that that is just not the case. The majority of people are either looking to move to a different location, upgrade their house, life changes, and most people just don't stay in their homes here in the Iowa City area for longer than maybe 5, 7 years.
That's right. Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, and those programs work out well. Yep.
Yeah. So is there any special documentation that is needed for one of these doctor's or physician's loans? Anything above and beyond what somebody might expect to have to hand over to you in the pre-approval process?
Yeah. What we normally do with residents, you're going to obviously have your match letter, and you may not get your match letter until, you know, after we've already pre-approved you. Again, we're so familiar with working with these programs. That generally will pre-approve you. You know, I'll probably know more about your income than you will at first. And so generally what we're looking for is quite simply a match letter or contract, which just indicates what your start date is and what your salary is gonna be. And we really go off of that. And if you've had work experience prior to this, we'll probably ask for your last 2 years W-2s. Obviously, if you're putting any money down, if you decide you wanna put money down, you don't have to. We'll ask for some bank statements, but that's basically it. That's all we need. It's very, very straightforward, very easy to do. There's not a whole lot of documentation. You'll see a lot more documentation when you're doing the conventional fixed rate financing. It's a little bit more intrusive from that side of things. But other than that, very easy. We had a Zoom a while back where we talked about international students. You'll probably need a visa if you're international, if you're moving in from out of the country. You'll likely need a valid visa. But outside of that, there isn't really anything special that you need outside of what we would normally collect. So.
Okay, I will leave a card up here on the screen for people who are watching this and are interested in purchasing a house and you are an international buyer. One more question for you, Pete. Is there a time requirement? I know sometimes people come in and they say, hey, I'm planning to start this program, but my job doesn't start for 60 days. I'd really like to move earlier. How do you make that time requirement work between when money is actually going to be coming in and when they want to move into the house?
Yeah, so that's another nice thing about our in-house loan. So when you're working with that conventional fixed rate, 30-year fixed rate program, and I should say too, there are some residents that qualify for conventional fixed rates. They just want a 30-year fixed rate. We can do that too. If you don't have any student loan debt, you have some down payment, we'll go that route, typically speaking. But the time frame on those, generally you have to move in, or I should say you have to start your job, okay, which would be your residency in this case, within 90 days of your close date. So you have to be within 90 days when you're doing conventional fixed rate. On our in-house loans, that's really not an issue. So we like it to be within reason. Obviously we generally won't do a loan, like a year out, for example. Or a year and a half out. We want to know that you've got some income coming in relatively quickly so that you don't get into trouble with the payments, obviously. Mm-hmm. But generally speaking, if you're 4 to 6 months out, I've done loans that far out before. I've done them a little bit farther out in special circumstances. But I would say with the vast majority of residents, most are waiting to get that match letter, in March or April. And before they commit to a house here. So generally speaking, you're matching in March or April, and then you're looking to close in June. So you're within, generally going to be within that, 90-day window anyway, but it's not a requirement. So.
Okay, perfect. Well, I'm going to leave all of Pete's contact information down below in the description box of this video. If you happen to be watching this on your phone, all you need to do is tap the title of this video and that description box will open right up. Or you can contact me and I can send an email introducing you to Pete. Whatever works best for you, either one of us would be happy to talk with you. Thanks for joining me today, Pete. I'm sure we'll be in touch again.
Thanks for the opportunity, Emily. Nice talking to you.
You too. Bye.